PBS Junior is a very democratic platform where we encourage children from different parts of India to come online and talk on issues that impact them, that involve them. So before we proceed with the show today, the Independence Day special exclusively for Chennai Public School, I would request the panelists to introduce themselves with your full name and one thing that you like and one thing that you dislike.
Hello, good evening, sir. Sir, my name is Advik Ganesh Iyer. I study in class 9 of Chennai Public School, Annanagar. And what I do love to do is play table tennis. I'm actually a state level table tennis player. And what I really do love is public speaking. And I have one a couple of MUN.
I'm Charvi Dhiran, studying in 10th grade of Chennai Public School. And I love reading, writing, and speaking.
My name is Isaac Matthew. I come from Chennai Public School. I am a strong supporter of youth empowerment. I would like to start off by saying what I like. I like the feeling that you get, the feeling of fright that you get, the feeling of enjoyment that you get when you play football. Those 90 minutes on that pitch, according to me, are like life itself. There might be minutes where you feel really down. There might be minutes where you go score a goal and you feel amazing. But overall, it's the culmination of both that makes the game good, that makes life good. And I dislike things like racism, like inequality. And obviously, everyone dislikes that. But I personally.
Very good evening and happy Independence Day to you all. My name is Kavya B.S. and I'm studying in class 9 of Chennai Public School. I enjoy reading and writing often, and I love watching various TV shows. And besides these, I'm very passionate about public speaking.
Okay, and what do you dislike?
Well, it's very short. I usually dislike bad attitude in people and unpunctuality.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, ma'am. My name is Varsha Chandrasekhar from Class 10, Chennai Public School. Other than public speaking, I have attending a couple of MUNs. I also do Bharatanatyam. I'm a seasoned Bharatanatyam artist. I give solo performances in the season, and I also learn Carnatic music and violin. I also am very interested in reading and writing aside from this.
So we are also very honored and privileged that we have Ashanathan Madam amongst us today. Thank you very much, Madam, for taking our time. It would be great if you could deliver the keynote address before we begin the show.
A pleasant evening to all. Freedom in the mind, faith in the world, pride in our souls. Let's salute the nation on Independence Day. My greetings to each one of you for a very happy Independence Day. At the outset, I would like to express my hearty thanks to the team members of the Bespoke Show for having invited me to be the keynote speaker for today's event. The initiatives being taken by the Bespoke Show in involving the student community from a number of schools across the country to debate and discuss on issues related to conventional and unconventional topics deserves a special mention. The themes chosen are truly custom-made. I'm even more elated that the students of Chennai Public School have been chosen to be the panelists to deliberate on the topic that is most appropriate for today's occasion of the 74th Independence Day. The topic appears to be self-effacing, yet very thought-provoking. It is indeed astounding that after so many years of independence, freedom still has a different meaning to different people. Should we say that the definition of freedom for any individual depends on what he or she may desire most, but are unable to experience due to certain constraints? Probably for some, freedom could mean freedom from poverty and illiteracy. For some, it could suggest freedom from the shackles of authority. And as we have the younger generation with us, let me tell you that freedom for them could mean amendments to be brought about in the education system to suit different learner needs, or something as simple as wanting to choose a dream career of their choice. According to the UN reports, India has the world's largest youth population, and it is said that the developing countries with large youth population could see their economies mount, provided they invest heavily in young people's education and health and also protect their rights. What can I do to change the world is the question that many of the young children are asking us today. They have the ideas, the creativity, and boundless energy to generate a positive social change in the world. Mr. Narendra Modi today, in his Independence Day address to the nation, said that a self-reliant India has now become the mantra for 130 crore Indians. For his vision of the Atmanirbhar Bharat to turn into reality, he said that he believes in the nation, its people, our beliefs, and our young citizens. To make all of this possible, we as educators and parents need to empower the youth of today with the necessary 21st century skills. To participate successfully in the global economy, we need to develop in the youth of today the skills of communication, collaboration, creativity, and critical thinking. In the working world, public speaking is a life skill. Public speaking requires excellent communication skills, enthusiasm, and ability to engage with an audience. A mastery of this vital skill helps in increasing the self-esteem and improves the power of persuasion. Good communication skills allows them to form connections, influence decisions, and motivate change. As public speaking is critical to have in an adult, grooming the skill as a child is one of the best ways to conquer it. It is now that we can appreciate platforms like PBS, which is encouraging young students to showcase their communication skills on varying topics. We are living in a fast-changing world, and if we continue to impart the same knowledge and skills that we learned many decades or centuries before, it will not suffice to address the challenges of the future. A generation ago, teachers could expect that what they taught would last their students a lifetime. Today, because of rapid economic and social change, schools have to prepare students for jobs that have not been created, technologies that have not been invented, and problems that we don't yet know but are likely to arise in the future. Our ability to meet the next generation's aspirations is crucial in boosting young India's potential and driving inclusive growth. To conclude, freedom is not the right to live as we please, but the right to find out how we ought to live in order to fulfill our potential, said Ralph Waldo Emerson. Thank you and Jai Hind.
Thank you very much, madam. Just taking your initial point forward, as you rightly said, freedom means different things to different people. Even after 73 years of independence, freedom means different things to different people. And the idea of India, again, means different things to different people. So India is an idea of confluence of aspirations, an idea of unity in diversity, an idea of several thoughts coming together, an idea of different kinds of cultures working together. So this is what we propose to discuss today and see what the young champions think about India, what means to them, what independence means to them. So maybe we will start with a very basic understanding of what India means to each of the champions.
Sir, basically, as a student, to me, freedom means to be able to choose your path, your career, and to pursue your dreams without being told it is wrong or impossible. And freedom to me means living in a country where regardless of whether... And freedom to me means regardless of where I live or in which country I live or regardless of my background or where I'm from, I am not being told that it is impossible. And if you have the grit, if you work hard enough, you will be able to pursue and achieve anything you want. And what I would like to say is that 2020 has basically tested me to balance both freedom and responsibility like no other recent year has. And with freedom, I would say, we get great power. And with great power, we have great responsibility. And it is probably our responsibility to make sure that our actions, they should never hurt any other person. And we should never hurt any other person's feelings. This is what I believe in freedom is.
Arvi?
I feel that freedom is being able to take your own choices to a point. So I feel that especially when parents bug you, they be like, you should do what we say. At that time, a thought comes to your mind saying that, I wish I had the freedom to take my own decisions. I wish I had the freedom to do what I like. Like many parents force us to take careers that we don't exactly want to. And at that time, the same thought crosses your mind. I wish I had the freedom to choose what I want to do in my future. So I feel freedom is being able to do what you want to do. Because your future is what you are going to live, not somebody taking the decisions for you. The decision that you take today is what is going to affect that is coming tomorrow. The choice that you take today is going to affect the consequences coming tomorrow. So today your parents force you to become a doctor. Tomorrow you're going to face the consequences that you're not able to do well in the medical field. So I feel freedom is actually taking the choices and being responsible for the consequences. So that when you take your choice with your own freedom, you don't have anybody else to blame in the future if you fail. When you prosper, you will be proud saying that this is my choice, or this is the choice I made with my freedom.
Awesome. I think straight from the heart, very honest answer. Are your parents around?
Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Freedom to me is the culmination of all that our national leaders worked for. Therefore, it is in its core a beautiful thing. Freedom is what all those leaders before us worked towards. However, if there are no safeguards against the misuse of freedom, it might lead to conflicts between not only the different units of the government, but also among people in general. Luckily, India has put down safeguards in place in order to ensure that freedom that one experiences is not at the expense of others. And there are some rights that are provided to the citizens that are absolute. These are basically the fundamental rights. And then there are others that are not. For example, the right to protest. It is, you know, it can be said that it's a right. However, it only gives citizens the right to protest peacefully. Peacefully being the key word. Now, another example is section 124A in the Indian Penal Code. It means it places limitations on the right to expression. It basically states that you can express yourself in any way you want, provided that it does not bring about hate to the country. And in conclusion, these show that although Indians do enjoy freedom, it does not mean that no limitations are placed. And hence, I conclude that as for India as a nation, as of today, freedom is not as much of a challenging issue as it is to many other countries. And so I can say with complete confidence that one, I enjoy abundance of freedom. Two, the freedom that I enjoy cannot be at the expense of others. And number three, I have the constitutional right to approach a court if I feel that my freedom has been violated.
I think you made a very valid point, Isaac, about freedom cannot be at the expense of others. Very solid point. I can draw a parallel to one term if you've heard, the Indian crab mentality. If you've not heard, please do read about it. So it doesn't mean that if you have to be successful, you have to pull down others.
To me, sir, freedom means to be responsible for your own actions. It means allowing myself to be who I am without any restrictions. And it's about thinking in my own way without any forceful influences on you. At the same time, freedom also means bearing the responsibilities of your own actions. Again, I agree with my fellow panelist, Isaac, saying that freedom should not come at the cost of someone else's basic rights and happiness. And if we were to have our freedom taken away from us, we would forget what progress means, and we would forget the ability for us to have to live a better life. That is the power of freedom. And all of us today have the freedom to choose what we feel and think and we have the choice between one action and another, and I think we should be very grateful for that.
Good point. I think that you made it right, made a right point by saying we have a lot of options today. In fact, it was not
exactly
there.
Yes.
Asha?
I'm planning to change my name from V because like all the four panelists have stated a lot. But one thing I would say about freedom is that it brings a sense of independence, I would say. You learn to make decisions on your own because you don't have someone coercing you into making those decisions. And when you do so, you have the chance of prospering in life. And again, like everybody else have said, freedom also means bearing great responsibility. So, and I mean, they have all stated the points, I guess.
You certainly pointed out regarding somebody else making career choices for you. Pointing towards parents again?
No, I'm because like my parents do give me the freedom to make choices. I have a sense of independence in me. Right. That's something that I feel this entire generation has because of the freedom we have been given.
Right. So parents,
it's important that we don't misuse it, correct, like the others have said, right, by pulling down others or the crab mentality, as you said.
Okay. So parents should play a role of only giving choices and showing how things work and then leave it to children to decide.
Not necessarily. I mean, like, in the end of the day, we're still buds who are yet to know the real world. They can give suggestions, but we should learn how to make our own decisions because at times in life, there will be circumstances where we would have to make tough decisions. And to be able to, we should be, these small decisions we make when we are young will be like the starting step for us when we make the decisions later in life.
Valid point. Great. Asha, over to you.
Yep. Thank you, Sid. Good evening to all and a very happy Independence Day to everybody. I absolutely love the way in which each of the children has articulated the concept of freedom, the conditions that go with it. Very amazing. Moving on, what comes to my mind is every 15th of August, we are reminded about the liberation that we had from the British colonialism, right? But along with it comes another concept, which is, today we pride ourselves of the Indian subcontinent. And what is Indian subcontinent? It's a consolidation of various princely states and smaller kingdoms, which to some extent, I think we owe to the British, right? So under these circumstances, how would we define our relationship with the British today? Is it a love relationship? Is it a hate relationship? Or is it a love-hate relationship? I would like to hear this from each of the panelists. So can we start with Advik again?
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
Ma'am, in my opinion, the argument that it is the British who created and formed a political union called India is definitely questionable. And because I feel that the only policy the British systematically had made is divide and rule and not unite and serve. And it is quite appalling that there are still Indians who think that we should be grateful to the British for this unification rather than Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, who was actually instrumental in doing this. And it was not only that, right from the epics like Ramayana and even in reality like Chandragupta Maurya and Ashoka, a large part of the Indian subcontinent was already united on the cultural front as well as the administrative front. And the atrocities committed by the British of over 200 years will make any Indian skin crawl. Yet, I believe that to hate will be a very huge burden. And what can we achieve by hating the British? We, as responsible citizens of the country India, we represent, we have got to make this country proud by working towards making it a superpower. That is what I believe. And further, I believe that the best revenge is massive success, and we are on our way to becoming a superpower. That's all I can say.
Great. Good perspective.
Thank you.
Shall we move on to Charvi?
Yes, ma'am. I feel that, in my opinion, hating is not the right way. I feel that branding a country, or in fact any person, for something that they've done in the past is completely wrong. I feel that we should judge them by what they're doing in the present. Are they helping us? Are they not bothering us? Or are they creating any threats or preventing us from growing as a superpower? Like, we know every aspect, be it anything, everything has its pros, its cons, its advantages, its disadvantages. So let me go to the part where the British tortured the Indians and they brought the policy of divide and rule. Let's keep all of that aside and look at it different, stop monarch rule and put their own rule. The Indians would have revolted against the monarch rule, but it would have taken a little amount of time to do that, for them to realize that what is happening with them is wrong. But when British came and they were tortured to an extent of pain that they would have gone through, then that is when the fire of freedom came into their hearts, that they want freedom. The pressure under which they were, that is what brought that thought in their mind, that this is enough. We have gone through the king's torture, now has come the British and they're torturing us. So now we need freedom. So we got freedom a little more before than we would have got if we were still under the monarch rule. Also, we got to read more of the Western and Eastern culture than we would have if the British hadn't come here. Even though we might argue that English is not needed in India, but we all know English is one language that is a general language that is used to communicate between countries. Now imagine, we might argue saying that if Hindi can be a language, but each country saying this would have just caused controversy, because today, wherever you go, you know English, you can communicate with them. So I feel that British has not done a very great job and it has probably brought hate in our hearts. But I feel, let's forget what they have done in the past and let's try to build a better relationship with them today.
Great. I think we have many things to mutually benefit from being friends with British. So moving on to Isaac.
Yes. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are.
Okay. While the British have retarded the development of India as a nation, I strongly believe that the British did have a role to play in helping develop the notions of the Indian ideal and those of the Indian idea. I believe that the British have in a way molded and shaped India into the nation that it is today. However, it goes without saying that the way that the British have oppressed the Indians is truly representative of the dark side of human temptation and people in general as well. And so, long answer short, I do not hate the British because I understand that they played a vital role in making India what it is today. I would like to lay down a few points. And the first point that I would like to make is that without British rule, there wouldn't have been a political union called India. And this is in a direct contrast to Advaik's point. And I would like to tell you this, the British did not make I'm not saying that they made it. What I'm saying is, before the British came into being, we were subjects. We were still subjects under the British. We were not equal. We were not citizens. We were subjects. But we were not being oppressed. But after, so we were fine with it. We were okay with it. We were living life. Back then, all we wanted to do was live in peace and die. That's all. But after the British came and after they started oppressing us, after they showed us truly the dark side of humanity, that is when the ideals developed. That is when we wanted freedom. That is when we wanted democracy. We wanted free press. We wanted the rule of law. So not only did it like contribute to the ideals of the Indian notion, but it also gave India the Indian democracy, the free press and the rule of law. And one more thing, India's democracy, the base of it is based on several constitutions, and one of those is the British Constitution. And the fourth point, the last point that I would like to make is surely, even if you hate the British, you cannot deny that the British did give us railways, tea, cricket, and the English language. Now, you can say that these would have reached India, but they would have reached India much later. Like, especially in the case of cricket, almost everybody you meet on the street has either played it before or is playing it now. Indians love cricket. Okay, it is played more than the national language hockey. Okay, that is how much people love cricket. So yes, my final point is yes, the way that British oppressed the Indians is horrible. Okay, but that does not give me a reason to hate them. Because if we hate them, we are no better than they are. Because hate only leads to more hate.
Great, Isaac. Very well laid out. I think what you mentioned about how India actually came into being because of the British is great a concept, because otherwise it's hard to speculate where we would have been, but maybe we would have been Bharat. We don't know, right? But on the other hand, it's like when push comes to shove, as they say, the oppression actually has brought us to where we are today, thanks to a lot of the freedom fighters who we owe a lot on this day, just like any other day. So shall we move on to Kavya?
Well, of course, we must acknowledge the fact that British rule here in India has actually shaped the habits and many attitudes of tens of millions of English-speaking Indians. So much of what we take for granted in our everyday life, for example, the books we read, the way we eat, sometimes the way we dress, our habits and cultural allusions are all a result of the British institution, colonialism, and the English language. But the abuses of the empire, though not forgotten, has been largely forgiven. India may not be the same nation that it was approximately 70 years ago. The past needs to be acknowledged and learnt from, but holding a grudge would be foolishness. As Mahatma Gandhi himself said, hate the sin, not the sinner. And besides, I believe that it's quite normal to actually hate British for what they have done to our country by stealing our resources and taking away our freedom. But to hate a group of people for what their ancestors have done would be simply wrong, I believe.
Yeah, that's a very positive way to look at it. Great. Varsha, I'd like to hear from you now.
Yes. The British had been cruel on India a lot. But what I would like to say is that actually, unintentionally, they brought us together. Because of the adversity, we learned to trust each other, learned to lean on each other, had each other's back because of it. And also, like Isaac has also stated, they gave us so much. Perhaps it could have been done in a better way. We could have learned the English language or other cultures. It could have been done better. But we have to have that common. We have to have something common with other countries, like the language. The language barrier is something that would be a real problem otherwise. And English has helped a lot. And English had been a major, this one for a major language, must for all the Indians. We learned it. And now we're able to communicate with other countries. And also, is a grudge really worth it? Because thinking about it politically also, the British are actually a great ally. So is it worth it? Is a grudge of the past worth sacrificing so much? So I'd say that, like Kavya also said, they have been forgiven, but it's not for what has happened has not been forgotten. We learn from the past. Isn't that what history is too? So,
yes. Sure. Love hearing these perspectives. And I'd like to take this opportunity just to share briefly that I have been associated with a British company for a long time in my career. And the best takeaway that I've had from there is a chunk of great friends from the UK. So it was nice to hear the younger generation giving a very positive reaction to this question. Thank you very much. Over to you, Sid.
Yeah. So I heard all of your views, and you acknowledge that we were oppressed. We were not given opportunities or whatever. and our freedom fighters gave their life for our freedom and independence. While we should not hold a grudge against them, and while we should not hate them for any reason, do you think it is right to spend millions of dollars, millions of pounds, and go and study there and work for them in Britain? So we see every year people applying to go abroad, go to UK and study for master's degree or undergraduate degrees. Do you think that is necessary? Start in the same order. We can start with Advik.
Sir, it's not that we don't have good institutions. We have actually world-class institutions, but it's just that for the following reasons that I'm about to state, we'd probably consider studying in the UK. So studying in the UK, basically, it opens up a world of new educational opportunities and helps expand your horizons. And since UK is a melting point for various cultures, and probably you get a chance to mingle with the people of various cultures and then get a global perspective of things and develop a mindset. And as far as working in the UK is concerned, I would also like to mention about the evolving trade relationship between the two countries. The tides have turned now, and India is one of the biggest investors in UK, and one of the top Indian companies are creating many jobs there. And I, for one, believe that the way forward is to hold no grudges and strengthen ties to mutually benefit in areas of engineering, education, and technological collaboration. This is what I believe.
Kervi, just adding on to what Advik just said, do you think it is necessary to go to UK only to study? Why not other countries? Is UK
Sir, I had mentioned earlier, UK is a melting point of various cultures. So many people go there for a reason, sir, and it opens up a world of new educational opportunities for us. It is a really special place to live and to study, especially the culture and the people you get to meet there. That is what I think.
What is your opinion on what Advik just said? Tarvi?
Sir, I feel that, to be frank, why do people go to UK? Not keeping anything else in mind. It is the pay. To be honest, it is the pay. The amount of money you get for a job in India, it is probably double or triple of what you get in UK. So people, not everybody thinks of patriotism when they're studying or earning. Most people think of what they're getting into it, their benefits, their money. So firstly, why do students choose to go to UK? Even US is an option, Russia is an option. There are so many other countries who have world-class educational institutes. Even India has it now. But why UK? Because UK is a place which has a lot of culture. Culture in the sense, not religion, language, and culture that we take in India. Culture is the open-mindedness of the people. People are very open-minded there. They're ready to accept you as you are. That is, they don't hold grudges. Like in India, you go, your neighbor's son is a doctor and you are probably something not so good, then that their mindset will be like, look at him, he's not a doctor, our son is a doctor. So there, people are really open-minded. They're ready to accept you for whatever you are. Even if you are a small businessman, people will really like what you're doing. So I feel it is for the money and for the open-mindedness that people go there to study and job.
Finally, £1 is equal to how many rupees? So that is what is important, right? Great. Isaac, your views on this?
So I believe that when dealing with topics such as this one, it is of utmost importance to keep in mind that India today is not what it was 70 years ago. Meaning that millennials of today are not looking for freedom, but for better job opportunities with a higher pay and also an overall better economy. And although India is doing well in these fields, it has not yet reached UK. And that is not my opinion. It is a fact. Okay, the UK, which is facing Brexit blues, had a GDP of USD 2.62 trillion, which is about USD 25 billion more than that of India, the data collected showed. I believe that there may be countless reasons as to why the millennials want to leave India for UK, but I do not want to waste time by focusing on that. I believe in the end of the day, the choice rests in the hands of the millennials. And the only thing that India as a nation or the Indian government can do is to show the millennials that the what they will be throwing away and what they will be cutting ties with and what they will lose when they leave the nation. And of course, the government can't force them to stay in the country. It can only try to change their minds. And when it comes to the struggles that the Indians faced during the colonial period, I believe that over the years, the value of their struggles has gradually tarnished, but that does not mean that they have been forgotten. I believe if a shift is implemented in the teaching and in the textbooks of Indian history, that should be enough. And I would just like to brush through a few points. This is not my opinion. This was actually a research which was conducted on why people want to leave India for UK. Basically, first I'll tell you the 5 points. They are aggressive society, 2, unchanging politics, 3, anti-everything families, 4, timid governments, and 5, inert justice. Now, I'll just basically go, it's a very, they are very big, really long, but I will simplify it. When it comes to aggressive society, this means that the society is basically passive-aggressive in the south and hostile in the north, okay? This upsets people. You can sense it on the roads, in shops, in cinemas, etc. I don't want to spend too much time on this, and I would like to say this is not my opinion. This is just research. And then second point is regarding unchanging politics. This refers to 2 aspects. I would like to talk about one. The first one is there are 6 national parties on the election commission's roster, 54 state parties, and 1,392 registered unrecognized parties. Yet, when you try to reach the parties with a problem, it's remarkably the same everywhere. They all have a jaded air. They all think they know more. They all jump to it when you're willing to fund the party. The narrowness of Indian political parties is like a sledgehammer blow when you actually face it. It drives people away. And then the third one, anti-everything families. I believe Chavi explained this very well, and I would not like to spend time on this. Fourth one, timid governments. I have not collected enough information to speak on this. And the fifth one, inert justice, basically refers to in India, okay, compared to other countries, especially like UK, the law system, if you pass in UK, 14 years, I mean, the guy who's being tried can die and it will still be going on. Okay, that's one of the major problems. Okay, and there are several other problems, obviously, but I do not want to focus on those. I basically believe that over the, in the recent years, that has reduced, okay, people leaving the country. So if we opt for development, I believe that we can solve this problem of people leaving the country.
So what I can infer from this is that we have the memories of the struggles of independence are slowly fading away. That is one. So we acknowledge that. And point two, if there is more development here, people will not leave the country.
Yes, yes.
Next, Kavya.
First of all, I would like to say that we are living in a world that is constantly changing, and we as the youth and the coming generation, we have to adapt ourselves to it by interacting with people from different countries, cultures, and generations. And that would mean studying abroad, let it be UK or any other country at all. And people have always been migrating to centers of excellences to gain knowledge and education. Why even great freedom fighters like Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru have studied abroad before they fought for our country. And I think we are the coming generation, as others have pointed out, we need to know how the world works and the cultures from different countries to actually make changes to it. That is basically my opinion.
All right. So you're saying there's nothing wrong if one goes there and studies and tries to apply their learnings. So even Jawaharlal Nehru has done that. Right. Varsha?
I'd say it's more of... Okay, Kavya, finish. It's okay.
Okay. Because, of course, as I stated before, we should not be holding grudges to a country because of what the past was. We are evolving and we need to adapt to it. And I don't think that our history should matter with what we are doing in our present.
Right. Varsha, would you like to add on?
Okay. I'd say that it's mostly because of the opportunities and circumstances that people opt to go for higher education and employment in other countries. But I personally feel, as someone who's also returned from the US and also has friends who have also returned from there, other countries too, to India, that there has been a large wave since around 2010 to 2015, starting from that time. The people have been coming back to India. And the people who actually leave the country are almost as much as the number who leave from other countries too. So because India is changing, India is developing rapidly that in the past few years, especially now with NEP also being introduced. So I'd say that we're coming up to the point where people would not leave as much as often as they used to leave for higher education. We're coming to the stage, so safe to say.
Okay. So once the NEP is implemented and we have...
And I think even the youth are also adapting. And of course, we also have a history. Our freedom fighters fought for us. And now that we also... Because there was this point, I would say, that people felt the need that going to other countries, especially the time when people used to say that green card was a big thing. Back then, there used to be this thing, green card. Having a green card was... a high profile in society. Now things are changing. Now being an Indian is, I feel that my generation do consider it a pride, especially. So awesome. Changing. There's awesome. A big wave and it's changing.
Great, great. Over to you, Asha.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Yeah, I think this international exposure is a great thing for making a better version of ourselves. But it's nice that we are evolving into a phase when others pride about coming into India as much as we used to pride about going abroad for our studies or for our work. After hearing so many insights from you about relationship with UK, let's move on to another country because I know you have a lot of interesting things to share. Now, US and India are talked of as the most talked about democracies. India is the largest democracy and US is the longest democracy. What do you see as the takeaways from, let's say, the US democracy if we were to take at least 3 points on that front? Certainly, the way the COVID-19 has been handled is not the one. But apart from that, I'm sure there are many things that we can imbibe from the US democracy. Would you like to share your thoughts on that, starting with Advik?
Well, I would like to begin by saying that stating the similarities between India and USA is like stating the obvious, and I would like to begin with the dissimilarities because I have quite a few points on that. Could I begin? Yes. So basically, in most democracies around the world, the political parties are formed along ideological lines. But in India, what we witness is that the political parties are formed along cultural, linguistic, religion, and caste-based lines. And here the vote banks are created where political parties are have a loyal block of voters from a single community, and they back only those certain candidates. And this probably has to stop. And in India, there is a culture of giving away freebies to lure voters into voting for that party. And this is another issue. Nepotism and dynastic succession have dominated the political scene in India for quite a few decades. And I, for one, believe that true democracy would prevail only when people from all walks of life get an equal chance and an equal opportunity to prove themselves and make our country great again. This is what I believe.
Great. I think this happens much easier in the US because they have just two parties that they vote into. And in India, we have multiple parties that are regional. Hopefully not religious, but definitely regional.
Can I add one point here?
Sure.
So he mentioned about creating parties on various lines, on culture or, you know, on religion. So yes, Advik, if you learn marketing in future, you have to create products that the market wants. So this is
right,
what...
sir. Right, sir. But it's become such a situation that, say, like, take a Hindu leader, for example. He will ask the voters who are Hindu to vote for them, right? That is natural. That's natural mentality, sir. But that definitely has to stop, as we are not judging the people based on their ideas and what they think of how well educated they are. We are just going with, and this is a problem with the average voter, sir. He doesn't know what to do. He or she doesn't know what to do, what to how to elect. That is all a problem, sir.
Exactly. Without getting into those details, I just wanted to make a point that you know, the market demands that. If market wants Maruti 800, the company would make Maruti 800. That's how
obviously, but some things have to change for the betterment of the country, I believe.
Carry on, Asha.
Yeah, it is changing, and Indian voters are becoming more and more conscious of their rights and of what vote gets them and what it doesn't. So I think we are getting there. Shall we move on to Charvi?
Yes, very soon we'll get there. I'm confident. Yep. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. So let me tell one point that is obvious. Mm-hmm. India has a very complicated governmental system, whereas US has a simple governmental system. We can see that. India has a parliamentary form of government, whereas US has a presidential form of government. So here, first you have to elect the prime minister, and then the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha elected people will elect the president. It's a very long process. Whereas there, you just have to vote for the president. So then, whereas India has, it can have multiple parties, to be honest. Whereas US can have only two parties. We all know that. And US allows dual system. You can be citizens of India as well as US. It allows that. Whereas India, if you are an Indian citizen, you have to cut ties with the other country. Then only you can be an Indian citizen. And then a judge in the US can hold his post until he has good health. So people who are workaholics, they love this there. So, you know, you can hold till whenever you have really good health, you're fit and fine, so you're a judge. You don't have to take retirement. Whereas in India, at least at 58, your retirement status comes. You have to go. You don't have a choice. Whether you're a workaholic or you hate work, you just have to retire. So what I feel we can take away from this is, firstly, giving dual citizenship. So people should be given the choice. Like today's youth expect that they want to be citizens of two countries. They should not be told that you can only be a citizen of this one country. Also, I feel that India should start making its system a little more simple so that people feel that giving a vote is good. It is easier. We know that many people don't hesitate from giving votes here. So when the system is simple, crystal clear, all I have to do is go and vote for a person. That's it. Also, we know that in US, the Rajya Sabha has more power, whereas in India, the Lok Sabha has more power. So I feel that maybe India should start giving more power to Rajya Sabha, because it is actually people's choice what they want from a country. As we know, the government is for the people, by the people, and the people should have a take in it. So I feel that people should be given power in India just like they are given in the US.
Great, Shavi. I think all of those are very relevant points, but the one point that you made about the retirement age or the working years is very relevant at a very micro level, because I think in India we have a mindset that if you are 58 or 60, you need to stop working, which doesn't really make any sense. You work as long as you can work and deliver results. Age is no barrier, really. And I think that's a huge point that we need to imbibe from the US. Well done. Isaac, can we move on to you?
So for this question, I want to keep it straight factual. I do not want to give my opinion, because obviously this is a straight factual question. Okay, so there are five differences. Okay, head of state, government, cabinet, legislative body, legislation authority, and federalism. So six, sorry, not five, six. So the first difference, basic difference, head of state in India, Prime Minister, USA, President. I don't want to elaborate and take up time there. We already know this. Then when it comes to the government in India, the government can lose the mandate if its majority cannot be proved in the Lok Sabha in the event of a no confidence motion. And in USA, the president is not dependent on the state of his party or his party in the Congress. Okay, in India, it's a parliamentary form of government, as I think Chavi said, and in USA, it's a presidential government. Then in terms of cabinet in India, we already know that the prime minister appoints the cabinet. In USA, the president nominates the cabinet members and sends them to the Senate for confirmation. And then when it comes to legislative body, the Congress is the legislature of the USA, and in India, the parliament is the supreme legislative body. Now, when it comes to legislation authority, so this is the one of the major differences, this and the federalism. So when it comes to legislation authority in India, there is no strict separation of powers. We learn this from sixth grade. They are all, it's a system of check and balance. They are all like, they're organs of the same body. Okay, but in USA, there is a clear separation of the powers between the executive, the legislature and the judiciary. As I think Advik said that it was, you know, it's simple in USA and it's more complex in India. Okay, and then when it comes to federalism, I believe this is the one of the biggest points. In India, it's a holding together federation. In USA, it's a coming together federation. And I personally believe that this is where the constitution makers of India shine. Because who knew that 70 years ago, around 70 years ago, they were able to predict which would be better for India. See, in USA, diversity exists, but not close to what it is in India. See, when you're diverse, okay, your main aim is to stick together. Okay, not to come together. You're already together in the same, you want to stick together. But in a coming together federation, which is practiced in USA, they are not that different from each other. They're not, you know, like differences based on religion, caste, gender, you know, and other topics. Okay, in India, there are more differences. That's why we need a holding together federation. So basically, I would like to conclude by applauding the constitution makers, because who can imagine that 70 years ago, around 70 years ago, they made the constitution. Okay, they made a constitution, like, and they took so many risks. Okay, and that is what eventually led to development. And that is what I believe that India today lacks. We need to take more risks, like was taken by the previous generations. They didn't know what would happen. They just took the leap. And we need to make the leap if we want to see development in the future generations. That's what I would like to conclude by saying.
And that's going to happen when more and more participation happens from the citizens in the electoral process. Great. Kavya?
Well, there are quite a few differences between the democracy in US and India.
Yeah.
The democracy in US is a form of presidential government, as it was told, where the head of the government is the president.
More than the differences, what I'm trying to understand is, what is it that we need to imbibe from them? Because we have spoken adequately about the differences, right? So is there something you feel should be replicated into the Indian system?
Yes. Well, first of all, I would like to point this one thing, that in some ways, the US is actually a young country because it was founded only a couple of centuries ago. But it is also one of the oldest democracies that exists in the world today. India, on the other hand, as a democracy, is just around 70 years old. But as a civilization, it has existed for over a millennia. First of all, both the countries can learn so much from each other if they acknowledge their differences and accept their similarities. And some of the ways that we can do that, for an example, is that in US, the central and the local governments and local governments are all dependent on the the local government and the state government is often dependent on the central government for financial and administrative responsibilities. Something that we can learn from the US is that we can also make our state governments and local governments independent to make faster implementation of changes. And something that the US can learn from us is that India is one of the only countries to implement the universal adult suffrage at the time of their independence, with no restrictions based on gender or race or any other factor other than age. And this commitment to the democracy is evident as in the higher voter turnout rates in India. So that is something that the US democracy can learn from us. Yes, that's my opinion.
Nice, Kavya. You brought in a very distinct perspective. Thank you for that. Varsha?
I guess being last means that I kind of lose all the points.
So maybe we should start
This is more of a factual question. So like, it's more of a research based, and I guess they did state all the points.
Yeah, right.
One thing I would like to state though, Charvi, dual citizenship is actually not that great because like we have to pay taxes for both countries. But still, so yes.
Yeah, but what also is not so great about US system is that the residents of California would probably pay a much higher tax.
One difference that's actually, I don't think so anybody mentioned, was the fact that the states have their own constitution over there.
Exactly, right. So it also
have that, over here, the states are more united. Right. Something I like about India. So
right, there's more uniformity, but there, I think, depending on the state in which you live, you choose what you get and what you lose. So that's an equally relevant point. Thank you. Interesting insights. Over to you, Sid.
Yeah, thank you. So we'll start with Varshai this time now and go further. So today we are so privileged that, you know, we got an opportunity to participate in TBS Junior. Nobody forced us to participate. We volunteered to participate, right? We had the freedom to say no, okay? We have an opportunity to talk in front of our principal. You know, you can voice your opinions when the principal is present. We are sitting in comfortable places with great laptops and systems with decent Wi-Fi connections, right? So we have the freedom to decide what we want to do in our career. We openly tell our parents not to interfere, just guide us. But do you think all people in India have the same level of freedom that we are enjoying? So where is the gap, Varsha? Specific cases, specific examples would be helpful.
I'd say that it's more of a society-related problem. The reason why not everyone has that freedom of to start with society, how people, as Chavi once stated, how the respect given to some people is not equal to the respect given to others. Encouragement is different. And of course, there's also the poverty, what class they are in. That plays also a major role too, because of which their freedom is curbed. They don't have that much freedom to do some stuff because they, even if, for example, they're going to get a case, they need a lawyer, they need to pay the money, and people who are poor don't have the money, which comes back to the point that they don't have the freedom to actually, their freedom is kind of curbed over there too. And then there's also coming to society again, caste also, it plays a major role too. People tend to judge people with their caste. Mm-hmm. And because of which, sometimes despite legally having their freedom, they tend to keep their opinions within themselves, not voicing out what their opinions are, in fear of what the consequences might be if stated out boldly. So legally there is freedom, but in other aspects, it's curbed, I'd say.
Okay. Kavya?
Yes. A factual information is that it has been many years since we have fought through the clutches of British rule here in India. But if we were to ask ourselves a question, are we really free from the inequality and discrimination that is practiced by the people in our own society? The answer would be no. And because crimes targeted against women and violence towards children are some topics that are not unknown to us. Caste discrimination is another social evil that is deeply entrenched into our society. It is quite understandable that our government can't just root out this discrimination by assigning quotas to jobs or colleges and schools. And that is why I think that we need to work on changing the mindset of the people in our society. We as a very independent nation have undergone so many positive changes since our independence that I think we should highlight on these few issues so that we as Indians could work together in harmony and come out of our comfort zone so that we can make a great nation such as India a better and more peaceful place to live in.
Any specific examples?
Well, as I said, caste discrimination and, well, crimes in general, actually. Nothing particular.
Okay. Isaac, would you like to add on?
So personally, I believe that this is a really sensitive topic. So I'm going to try not to overstep my bounds. So basically, see, we went through oppression. So we like when the constitution makers, as I said, were making the constitution, the one basic thing they had in mind is that the constitution should provide freedom. Okay, everybody should be free. Okay, but let me tell you a few things. Okay, first of all, like there are areas where it's not directly related to freedom. Okay, example, Hindi was made the official language, and I have nothing against Hindi. Basically, what happened is when Hindi was made the official language, I have seen this in my personal life. See, the parents know that it's not the national language, that it's just the official language, but it creates this feeling in our minds that you are somehow obliged to learn Hindi because you are a part of India. And I believe that this, as I have seen this, because I live in Chennai, I have seen this a lot. It has made other languages such as Tamil, Malayalam, Telugu feel inferior in certain respects. And I'm not saying that they are. I'm saying that it has made them feel. So the gap, okay, the gap comes when we pass laws that are technically, yes, they do provide freedom. Okay, they are like leading towards freedom. They are leading towards nationalism. But nationalism, however, when we make laws, we have to make sure, okay, we have to completely make sure that it does not lead to other castes, etc., becoming inferior. We should not make anyone inferior. This could also be one of the reasons why people leave the country. So yeah, that's basically all I have to say.
Okay. Darvi?
Okay, so India, okay, we have various cultures, languages. If I keep going, there's a whole list of how diverse we are. But then I feel mainly a girl child or a woman is the one who's discriminated the most. Let's be honest. Here, in the name of religion, in the name of culture, we are told how we should live. Family members are like, behave like a girl, sit like a girl, dress like a girl. Don't go out at night. It's not safe for you. You know, you should be of a good, nice color. You should be thin. You should be this way, or else you won't get married. You won't find a good house. It's everything, we have a condition that we have to be this way. We have to bend according to the society tells us to. Now it is much better. But before, a woman trying to prosper, they were always suppressed. Even today, in many regions, many places, women are told to not go to school, to not take up jobs, to not go with their career. They're told to sacrifice their career just to get married. This is one point. Another point is today, the government, just to bring down discrimination a bit, they introduced this thing where lower communities, backward castes are given seats in colleges. But then it kind of turns out that it backfired on them. So that is, today people who are giving out seats, they like, we'll give out the seat only to the same community. Or else, even if a person who's a lot more better than that backward class person is not given a seat in that college, just because that person is backward class. Now, in this case, the ability is not seen. Only because the government has told that the backward class gets the seat, he's getting the seat. What about the other person who's not backward and has done great, 100 on 100 in all subjects, state is great in sports, everything, but just because he's not backward class, he does not get that seat, which is completely unfair. And even though racism is not something that is seriously taken in India, but let me be truthful, there are circumstances where color is taken in consideration in marriage, in job opportunities, in interviews. Many people judge you by your color or your language or where you're from. So I feel these things should be taken into consideration in our country. Now it should be taken seriously. Thank you.
I think very valid point regarding gender discrimination. In fact, that is also related to female feticide, female infanticide, female literacy. In many states, we are fortunate, as I said in the beginning, we are very fortunate. Things are not better now. You know, maybe it's better in the urban areas, but things are really bad still in many parts of the country. Human trafficking, bonded labor, child labor continues to exist. In fact, I have written a book called Bihar Ki Beti in English. The title is in Hindi. So it's available on Amazon and Flipkart in case you want to read. Okay. So I think these are the issues which still continue to plague the society. And freedom in its literal meaning, everybody is not enjoying the same level of freedom.
Like I stated before, so you know, freedom is what it should be your choice. Like the PR girl child is not given their own choice to take that decision.
Exactly. So it's not just about decision. There, the situation is even deeper. The problem is much deeper than that. So anyway, so valid point, Charvi. Thank you so much for that. Advik, your views.
Let me again go ahead with the question. We have had 7 decades of independence, but is India free? We have to free ourselves from the shackles of casteism and discrimination on the basis of religion. And are we free from the regressive mindset towards women? Are we free from, and are they treated properly? And violence towards them? All this definitely has to change. Are the students free to choose the career they want, the dream they want to pursue, the passion they want to do? And all this without reservation, like so many of the other panelists had also mentioned, without reservation, this is another problem. Is the government working without any corruption? Another question. And are children safe? Are they even safe and secure? That is one of the basic rights, and parents still doubt whether they are safe. Are we free from child labor? These are all another question. This is another question. Are we free from even the basics like poverty, hunger? Are we free even of them? And the answer to all this question is unfortunately no. Things are definitely slowly changing, but we as responsible citizens have to bring in a change. We have to develop ourselves and develop the nation accordingly. And the answer to all this, one of the main reasons why all these take place is due to the fact that there is still economic disparity. What we see here is that only a handful of people enjoy a monopoly over all the resources, and it's not distributed equally in a uniform way among all the people. And this has to change. And I would like to conclude by saying that we will get rid of all this only when we get rid of all the old norms, like reservation, caste. They're all just superstitions. We've got to get rid of all this to become independent and a developed nation. This is all what is required. And I'm hopeful that we will be able to do so very soon. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Over to you, Asha.
Thank you, Sid. Maybe one last question from me. Have you ever had a chance to talk about India of pre-independence with your grandparents? And if so, what's your impression of India pre-1947 and post-1947? Maybe just a one-liner from each of you, starting with Varsha.
My grandparents weren't actually born around that time, so
okay.
They were just like 5 years old.
Okay.
But I mean, actually, there's been a great change even from when my parents were here. I mean, starting with the money to how society is. Mm-hmm. So I'm pretty sure that India has developed a lot from what it has been, and it's because of the path our freedom fighters have paid for us.
So we have come a long way, you think?
We have come a long way, and even though we still have a long way to go, like Advik said, to become a superpower,
right,
we will become one for sure at this rate.
Sure, nice to know that. Kavya?
Well, compared to the India now, the India back then used to have cleaner air and water and better environmental situations, I think. And it is quite justifiable because of the massive growth in population in our nation over the last few decades. One prominent difference that my own grandparents have often told about how prices of goods have increased today compared to the days of their youth. And that is true because today our economy has increased a lot. We have achieved incredibly in technology and medicinal fields. And our means of communication and transportation has also become faster and easier. Back then, people, if they wanted to communicate with one another, they used to write letters or use phone booths. And today it is replaced by iPhones because nearly everyone in the country can afford it. What I notice when I hear all of this is that life today is so much more easier and faster and more comfortable compared to the days of our parents and grandparents' youth. And that is, we can say that our country is evolving a lot and we should also adapt to it.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think prices have increased a lot, Kavya, maybe more to do with the purchasing power of money rather than the prices per se.
Yeah,
that's something by itself. Exactly. Can't be covered here, but that's a good point. Isaac?
Yeah, so basically, I agree with everything that the previous the panelists who came before me said. Most of it was what my grandparents said. But one thing I personally visualize is that as the years have passed, the previous generation or the parents or the traditions of the country, they're being changed. So before it was not acceptable. Many things which are acceptable today were not acceptable back then. And I believe this is one thing that if India succeeds in this field, like completely, in making sure that like we are developing according to the wishes of the millennials, of the younger generation, and not with that of the older generation. Because when the people who are younger, their views are completely different. I can say because I am younger. Okay, so one thing I will say is if India keeps going in this path, it will lead to success. I am sure of it. And
great. Charvi?
Okay, this question is, I have so much to say on this. Like it is, India has changed drastically. So I think today only I went to my grandmom and I was like, what do you think India was like before? So she was like, I was not exactly born, but I feel it was really peaceful. I'm like, how can it be peaceful? The British were torturing us and you were living in a time of war, crisis. She was like, okay, I was not born in that time, but I do know how, because my grandfather was alive. So she was like, you know, my grandfather used to live in the border of Pakistan and India, and the partition was going to happen. So, you know, he came in bullock carts with everything he could take, and she was describing the scene to me. And I was like, wow, I can't even imagine myself in his place. Like, today I'm scared to go on a bus stop and go on my own. And at that time, in between people killing each other and war and crisis, they had the strength to go from the Pakistan border to Rajasthan. And I was really surprised of how life was at that time. Also, I feel that I imagine myself being in a sari with the thing always on my face. I'm like, I can't even imagine my life without jeans and t-shirts and all that. How, even in the sizzling heat, they used to wear all those bangles and all that. I'm like, how? I can't even imagine my life that way. So even visualizing how India was at that time gives me the chills now. I'm like, I can never live in that era. I'm actually so glad I'm born right now. So I feel that India has actually become a much better place than that it was at that time. And I'm actually thankful that I'm living in such a comfortable era where I have a security of everything. I have a house to live in there. I have 3 meals a day. I have water. So I feel if India keeps developing this way, one day we'll probably not have the poverty also that we're having today. Thank you.
Okay. Advik?
Okay, so let me be honest. The truth is that I actually called my grandfather to answer this question. And what he reckons is that in those days, people were kind-hearted, they were honest, and they were very ritualistic, I should say. Mm-hmm. And those times there was more time for the finer things in life, you say, and money back then had value. I mean, those dosas, they actually cost 20 annas, and I was actually quite surprised to know because I never knew. And in my grandfather's time, he bought a land for around 1,000 rupees. This is what he told me. My father had to buy a land for lakhs of rupees, and only God knows how much money I would have to pay, how many crores of rupees I would have to pay to buy a land. God only knows. And women were pretty much restricted to perform household chores at this time. And compared to now, women are bold and they are working and they are making a difference in this modern India. I could say that with complete confidence. And she believes that, my grandmother believes that movies made in those days had much better content than the movies made now. But let me tell you, I disagreed very much. I said, no, movies now are 100% better. And she disagreed, of course. And they are of the opinion that India now, which is obviously, has made humongous progress in science and technology. And I also agree with what they say in that way. they say that although our generation is smarter generation than theirs, theirs was more simple, stress-free, and a happier one, we could say. And this is all he had told me. He would have gone on.
Yeah, they're also right, actually. I think there's nothing right or wrong about what it was then and what it is now. I think as we evolve, it gets customized to the needs of the hour. And so it's just nice to throw back and find out what was good then and what's good today.
And I also remember him speaking about the how large the families were. At that time, he said that they lived in a large joint-sized family and now we just have nuclear families. So.
Absolutely. Yes, that's a big difference.
Yeah.
Great. So, to conclude, I think I don't have to say anything. All of you have said everything that needs to be said, and I think I would only be repeating what you said if I were to summarize this. But I would like to close this with a two-liner from Rabindranath Tagore's Gitanjali, which is very relevant today. Where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, into that heaven of freedom. And I think it's been a great session talking to the kids of Chennai Public School. You have really inspired many kids of your age today. You've all been terrific. And you've only proven that the future is in safe hands. Thank you, Advik. Thank you, Kavya. Thank you, Charvi. Thank you, Isaac. Thank you, Varsha. Thank you all for making this exciting session happen. We were very privileged. Wish you all the best in all your future endeavors.